All right, I can have you start the timer. All right, ready for countdown?
Yep.
All right, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, so normally we would have just come out of that first intro cutscene, and the reason why we're able to skip it is because it's an option in the game, but for some reason that's showing up right now. I don't know. A lot of people have been using my computer. Oh, you've slipped into something comfortable. If you're new to town, so you notice that the movement is pretty similar to like Half-Life games and stuff like that, because this is on sort of a beta source engine. This came out around the same time that Half-Life 2 did. I think they were the first ones to really license out their source engine first. It didn't get a lot of a good press release though, because it was released pretty much like maybe a week in between, not even, I forget exactly how long.
All right, here's what we got today.
But that's why we can bunny hop, slide along the walls fast, stuff like that. You'll also notice there's some numbers in the top right corner of my screen. One of those, the player velocity at the bottom, helps to show how many units I'm moving. And the other things are kind of like the FPS. This game is really FPS dependent, so like whenever I go through a door, I changed the default FPS from 300 to 60, because otherwise I can't like react with it, or act with it.
The door?
Yeah, the door will just like get stuck onto you instead. So for this first mission here, you're not supposed to be able to open that door, but we just jumped on top of it or whatever. And then the whole point of this quest is to get the Astrolite back for Mercurio. That's the first quest. So I just did that. You may also notice I haven't talked to Mercurio yet, and that's because it's slower to talk to him twice. So I'll just do it twice in a row.
This game can, like, screw up if you get an item and then don't trigger the actual quest, right?
It's got a lot of little finicky crap about it. It's weird. Right, so that first conversation is like, oh, go get my, you know, bomb stuff. And then we already did it, so now we're just going to tell him we have it. And he tells us to go to the nightclub and have a good time. Well, the plot is that he's a ghoul. And so, yeah, he can take that sort of damage and not just, you know, die or some shit. But, yeah, you're supposed to help him out. For the prince, basically.
Aren't you just well?
So right there is a small kind of trick. Jeanette wants to talk to you, and she likes to run up at you as soon as you get there. But if you wait just a second, she will come running up at you, and then you can talk to the get in front of the bartender, and then you can talk to him during the cutscene. Which is nice. Save you a little bit of time. Alright, so right here there's a long conversation between Jeanette and Therese, but we'll skip it by quick saving and reloading.
Therese. Tons of. Rumor. Oh, before I. If you look.
So are all the cutscenes in this game just the dialogue boxes, or are there actual real cutscenes?
There's real cutscenes as well as the dialogue boxes. One of them is particularly long and you can't skip it. It's kind of unfortunate. So Jeanette just asked us to go to the Ocean Hotel, which if you've played this game before, I'm sure you remember the Ocean Hotel. It's got some pretty neat tricks in it too. They go fast. So for those of you guys who don't know about the game, the game was developed by Troika Games, which went out of business like shortly after the game released. They put out one patch for the game while they were unpaid, which is what I'm playing on right now, so this is official 1.2. But it's pretty broken. because there's some really weird shit with the game. Like, one error is, like, the game only assumes that you could only ever have 2 gigabytes of RAM. And so if you have over that, it assumes you have less than 512 megabytes of RAM and won't let you run the game.
Is that just the new patch, or is that any copy?
It's any copy, I think. Except if you get, like, unofficial patch, which obviously fixes it. But I can't use unofficial patch. It's slower.
Develop your own patch, man.
Yeah. The speedrun
yeah,
patch.
Yeah, speed.
The guy who made the patches, his name is Wesp5. I actually asked him about that, and he felt it was kind of arbitrary and dumb to make, so it's not happening. Can you just leave in this glitch? Thanks. So here, the particular about this room is that we have to take damage in order for this microwave to fly into this door. So we're going to wait for this pot right here to get all mystical, and that's going to hit us, and then we're going to go right for the door. Oh my goodness gracious. Can you please? It didn't hit the door. There we go. Wow, okay. So that didn't work as it was supposed to.
God, dude, that looked perfect. Yeah, that's pretty good, yeah.
The reason you don't want to take a ton of damage is because coming up is something called the Hallway of Pain. And it basically almost kills you. So the fact that I'm at really low life isn't that great.
This game has, like, quick saves, though.
It does.
You
do, if you want to, yeah. But instead, I'm just going to take it slow and just kind of duck underneath the steam that otherwise you'd run it up through. Oh, okay. We almost died anyway. Cool. So there's a cutscene that plays as soon as you open the door, but you can skip it by jumping. Makes it all nice and mystical. Now we have the thing to leave, and we can leave. Oh, I didn't explain the trick at the beginning, which is basically if you crouch over where the game tries to pull you into the basement, you kind of go over like the hitbox of where it would pull you down, and then instead just like jettisons you up the stairs, and you skip half of the Hoshin Hotel. Okay, so now what I gotta do is I gotta go talk to Therese to give her the pendant. But first we have to tell Jeanette that we're not gonna do anything she wants us to do. This elevator I'm riding in is notorious for, like, messing up. Like, you'll hit the button, but then it wants you to hit it again because it didn't like you the way that you hit it. So that's why I wait sometimes before I hit the button. Alright, so here, Therese wanted us to give us the pendant. We said no. She wanted us to go slash the paintings. We said no. So now we have to wait for her to turn back into Therese. So we have to exit this level and then just go right back in. The game, like, they probably put this option in at the last second because the game just assumes that you're definitely going to go do the quest that Jeanette wants you to do. So it even, like, loads stuff for you. Like, Officer Chuck is originally from here, so he'll load up. But we refuse to do it, so fuck Jeanette.
Is there anywhere in the game that can just randomly crash?
Yes. Yeah. Every point of the game can randomly crash, pretty much, as far as I know.
Excellent. Jeanette, there's
are there, like, I asked, things you avoid I want to doing see my sister. They yes, kind of I'll count it off once I've spoken with have more myself. Chance of crashing? Just do my ass.
It's not so much an issue here, but later on, there's a guy, well, an NPC, his name is Officer Chunk, who I mentioned was from here, and he's notoriously bad for softlocking, and so you kind of, like, don't talk to him quickly, because otherwise he can, fuck up. Alright, so now we're asked to go to the diner. We're supposed to meet someone here, you know, but instead it's a trap. Oh no. Can you feed, please? So the reason you want to end this this part with a feed because it makes it less likely that the police will show up.
What does feeding get you?
It gets you blood and health back. Okay,
so
good.
So is there still a chance the police will show up anyway?
Yes. I'm not entirely certain why the police show up. I just know that it's usually consistent that if you feed on the last person that they don't show up.
Okay. And what do they do?
They lock the door on you sometimes, or they will chase you around, which can take up to like 3 to 5 minutes for them to like actually leave you alone. All right, so this is one of the longest conversations in the game.
Don't listen. Shut up. You never. Isn't it? You're one.
One of the good things about playing Tremere, though, is that we get enough persuasion to get through pretty much all of the dialogue options. So these options in blue.
Father, don't listen.
The fastest thing to do is to save both of them.
Why? To reach next, if you do more, of course. But I only do.
And the reason why we save both of them is it saves us an elevator ride and it gets us extra. An extra experience point, which doesn't really matter, but it's mostly just you don't have to go. You don't have to ride down the elevator again. You just get warped right outside to the nightclub.
So if you don't save them, they die?
They like kill one of themselves off.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, because they're like a split personality or whatever. Alright, so this is the guy we've been looking for the whole time. And now we can go use the astrolite that I got in the first mission to blow up this Sabbat warehouse. Which is what the prince wanted us to do at the beginning. So we're almost through the first part. Get in there.
Done runs on the original patch or the non-patched version?
I've not, no. I assume that it's just really unstable, yeah. And I don't know what would happen. So here, I'm disarming this explosive, and he hit me. That's amazing. The reason it's amazing, because usually I'm inside there, but he's being a jerk for whatever reason. I'm gonna be safe and feed on this guy because my health got really low. Normally, this part's a little random because these two guys in this room, they can like both be in the front room or they can both be in the back room. It kind of depends, and it's better to have them both be in the front room because you can kind of trap them back there. They won't mess with you while you're setting up the bomb. Okay, so right here is a really cool trick. I'm going to save just to see if I can showcase this to you guys. This water tile is supposed to fall in this box, but when you crouch into it, that happens. Let me try again.
Is it supposed to happen?
Kinda. You're not supposed to be the one jumping into it, though. So that helps us skip a small second. It's a little finicky though. You have to hit right the edge of the like the right side of the box as you turn onto it.
Oh, yeah.
And the optimal route is actually to fly above the rail cars because you get that much height from it. It's really hard to hit that though. Like really nice and consistently. I've never gotten a run with the rail cars over it, so. Alright. No, it saves probably like oh, a good 20 seconds at least.
Really?
Yeah, at least. Alright, so this is the cutscene that I can't skip. That I wish we could skip, but we can't skip. So the story at this point is, this is the Sabbat who are catching up with me for blowing up their warehouse, and they're understandably mad about it.
Why exactly did you blow up their warehouse? I mean, it was their warehouse. It seemed like it was doing anything.
Well, because there's like this sort of war between these two vampire clans. This was the Sabbat. They're supposed to be more like a wild feral type, like don't care if people know they're vampires. Whereas the side that I've joined, I guess, who the prince told me to go blow up his warehouse, they're the Camarilla, and they're all concerned about upholding the masquerade and being douchebags, I guess.
Leave.
And then this guy Nines, he's from what do they call them? The anarchist or like an independent subgroup that doesn't like either of them. Just wants to do his own thing. Another really high tier part about this part is he says, "Oh, what are you gonna do? You're gonna shoot me?" And then later on he shoots him. It's great.
You're both dead. Nobody messes with the Sabbat and lives.
Keep moving. Trouble sure seems to like you. Good effort. Execution needs
shot him after all.
You look like shit. Want me to... This is a mean existence. Stay out of trouble, kid.
Kinda. Usually it's one, actually. Yeah. You skip dialogue by pressing, like, possible options that you could do. Like, 1 through 4, typically. Which is good. There's a lot of dialogue in this game. So, Nines asked us to go stop by the last round to talk to him, so we're going to do that and just basically tell him we don't care about him.
You got to be kid out.
Okay. But we have to talk to him, so whatever. The game also kind of has GoldenEye strats, where if you look at the ground, you can gain some FPS and move faster. Now I need to take a save. Oh, why did I need to load? But I need to take a save at least every time I go to talk to Officer Chunk, because he's got a lot of conditions for why he screws up. Yes, every single time you talk to him, there's a chance that he can softlock and won't talk to you when you come back.
Do you know how many times you have to talk to him? Now,
you have, do not, the last... At least 4 times, I think.
Oh, nothing I have.
Forget it. Good. Yes, okay, good. Yeah, thank you.
One more thing.
Took the wrong dialogue option. Alright, so now I have to go back to Santa Monica, and I have to go on to the Elizabeth Dane, and I have to investigate the sarcophagus, which is the main plot device of this game.
When is this set? Like, what time period?
I don't know. Probably 90s or some shit, you know? Elizabeth Dane. Alright, so this guy thinks we're a journalist. So he's gonna give us the police report, which is really nice. He's also gonna decide to screw himself up, and he's gonna keep asking if that's me. Yo, Pally. Yo, Pally, over here. So we just needed to turn the deck cams on so we could check out the sarcophagus. So we do that all from that room. And now we can leave. This is the quest I was talking about where Nosferatu, they can't talk to that guy because he's so ugly. So he has to go get the actual police report, which is closer to the actual sarcophagus, which has, it's like swarming with policemen over there, so it's kind of difficult to get.
So the police in this game know that you're a vampire?
No, they don't know I'm a vampire. But when you do illegal things, they come after you. Yeah. And getting, like I said, can take 3 to 5 minutes for them to like give up looking for you. And you can't go into buildings or talk to people while you're the police are after you, so it's awful. I'm going out of my way to take extra dialogue options to be mean to Chunk, in case you're wondering. Alright, this is another good cutscene. You want to pay attention to the dude in the red coat's coat as he walks out. Every time.
And the... Those visible? Yes, for the moment. Yes. When we hear from Grouch, he may come back.
Alright, so now he's asking us to go check up on one of these, like, leader types of the clans. This guy named Grout.
No. You should...
Alright, so the mechanic in this place is that there's some guys who have, like, headaches, and then there's some guys walking around and, like, that. And the guys who are walking around trigger the other guys when they get aggro. So I'm going to try and trance these guys, which makes it so they don't notice me. And hopefully it won't trigger any of these other guys from, you know, chasing after me. For this puzzle, he turns on the light in the middle, which needs to be on to solve the puzzle. So you can just come in and mash that, and eventually it'll solve itself. Oh, okay. I tranced this guy instead of that guy. It's alright.
So do you gain spells throughout the game?
Yeah, you can spend experience to get more if you want. The core spells that you start with, though, are really good. Like trance, which... I'd explain trance. Purge is what I used in the diner. It's like an AoE kind of thing that makes them take some damage, but more importantly, it makes them throw up blood for a while.
Do you need to buy any spells?
Yeah, we'll buy one. It's called Blood Shield, which shields you in blood. It's really good because we take a lot of some like fall damage sometimes, and it'll help negate that.
Is trance the only way to kill through it without being detected?
You could purge.
Okay.
Purge would probably work as well. But trance only costs 1 blood, whereas purge costs 2. So it's a little better to use trance. The other skill we get that I didn't mention is blood strike, which is like a projectile thing that scales with like the level of the thing that it's hitting. So the fact that I'm like under level doesn't matter. Uh-oh. Oh, there we go. Okay. So that's what I'm going to use to get through some harder fights once I actually have to fight things. Alright, he's right in front of the door, so I gotta punch him away. Come on, let me in.
Just a random enemy.
Yeah, well, he got aggroed from in here, and now he won't let me open the door for whatever reason. There we go. So I jump right at the end there to not get stuck. Then I'm coming in here. This is really important to get, and you'll see why in a second. And here is a bunch of Elder Vitae, which I absolutely need to finish the game, so I have to go out of my way to get that stuff.
What does it do?
It's a blood pack. It lets me like get blood back without having to feed. Like this. Elder Vitae heals you all the way and gives you full blood. And you get two of them out of there just for getting the key. So, yeah, it's really important to get. I love getting staggered. This is Grout. He's the leader or the primogen of the Malkavian clan. And he was a really smart dude before he became a vampire and started going all crazy. So he's got like a nice elaborate house. And this, she's not showing up yet, but this is like his wife. And he was trying to like help her out, you know, like turn her into a vampire to save her from some incurable disease. But now he's dead, so she's just gonna stay there forever.
She dead?
She's like a vegetable or some shit, man. Yeah, so there's Grout.
Did he change? Oh, no.
Oh, come on, dude. Leave me alone. Come on, dude. Yeah, so now the house is on fire. Those guys are like religious fanatics who hate vampires, you know? Oh, fuck. Okay, I will not jump over the edge and die. That would be fun.
So is there like a time limit before the house burns down, or is it just...
No, it's just on fire now. Okay, this is the most notorious conversation for Chunk to softlock at, so we'll see what happens. Okay, he's softlocked, and the reason why I know he's softlocked is because he didn't talk about space burgers, which is what he needs to do. He needs to talk about space burgers. What a jerk.
You have no idea how to
trigger it or... Nope. There are certain clues, like, if he's standing up, you're going to talk to him too soon.
Yeah.
What a jerk, dude.
How many attempts does it normally take?
Usually, he can just not softlock. So, this is a ridiculous... There he goes. Usually, that's a ridiculous amount. So he was being a fucking jerk, which he always is, though. So you know, just fuck him, as far as I'm concerned. Why didn't you guys pick Nosferatu?
Look at me. I need to control the manifest.
Yeah.
I have fuck.
Here the key. So is that the last time you have to talk to him?
No, I will talk to him one more time, which is when he would softlock.
Yeah.
And technically, you have to talk to him right at the end as well. He's the final boss, so. Probably. Yeah. Yeah. I don't see why not. I've forced him to softlock. I've never had him actually softlock in a run. So that would be...
How do you force a softlock?
You talk to him too quickly.
Oh.
Yeah, the whole thing, like, a lot of what the unofficial patch fixes is it just gives the game time to actually do things.
Yeah.
Which is why it's slower. Like, the conversation I skipped by quick saving and loading, that's actually put on a timer in the unofficial patch, so you have to sit through that, like, them arguing for like 3 minutes. Because that's just how that works. Oh, okay.
Are you supposed to know the password at this point?
No, you're supposed to get it, but I know it, so. all of the computer and the password and everything is all static, so once you know it, you know it. So I trance that guy to get a key card to get into this door. And sometimes when you do like a little circular motion over those lasers, he likes to run forward. I don't know why. It probably doesn't have an effect on him actually doing it. It's just placebo.
Yeah, it looks cool.
It does look cool, yeah.
Oh, what? No. Oh,
so if you kill that guy, would you just like loot the body for the key, or is it you're screwed and you kind of have to reset?
No, you can kill him as well, but you lose experience. Like, they want you to do it sneaky.
Yeah.
That's supposed to be a sneaky mission. Yeah, it's important to know when Chunk is supposed to say things or not. Like, we just fucking told him off, so, like, he didn't say shit.
At least I... Stoop! Stoop! And I want you... Then Hollywood's fine.
Alright, so now we're almost in Hollywood. Hollywood's fun. It's got a really big skip in it for Hollywood. Why did I go to Santa Monica? Fuck. Why do you spawn on the other side of the taxi where you can't talk to them?
You're the passenger, man.
There we go. Hollywood is also the worst hub because it has so many NPCs walking around on it that it just lags. So, utilize a lot of golden eye strats here. Watch the chair. There it is. Alright, this will be interesting. I don't have audio for this part, but we need to wait for him to finish saying everything that he says. Because otherwise, when you come back in, he'll say it all over again. He's done. Okay.
If he does say it, like if you don't wait and you go back in, you have to redo all the...
Yeah, he says it all again, and then you can talk to him.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Right there, I tranced our childhood friend who recognized us. Nice, easy way to just mitigate that whole thing. Now what we're doing here is we're looking for a videotape that has some creepy smut footage on it. Because Isaac is a pervert, I guess. So we have to go talk to this guy. And then we're going to do a kind of a big skip. It's a really unfortunate skip because the way it works is I'm going to get stuck in a door and then I'm going to quick save and load. And for whatever reason, in this game, when you're permanently stuck, it warps you upwards. So I'll be traveling up the wall. It's kind of finicky. Like, usually you don't want to get stuck indoors, but this door is hard to get stuck in. So right here, I'm getting the information for the first tape, if I could spell it right. If I could spell it right. If I could spell it right. There we go. Yeah, so the one, I was saying it was unfortunate. The one reason it's unfortunate is that it doesn't skip all of Hollywood, as I thought it was going to when I first found this out. And the other poor part is we still have to get the first tape. And we have to watch the cutscene twice. So, this saves time, but it could have saved more. Okay, I dropped.
So how much time does this save, would you say?
2 minutes.
Okay.
So you can see the camera position is going up. It's at 2.06, 19.83. That's not good. I dropped. Yeah, I dropped. The point is you want to get up the door before it closes on you, kind of. And, like, you do that by getting to the point where you're stuck, but then it opens, kind of. And then you kind of travel up it. That should be good now. Once you get far enough up the door, you're permanently stuck inside of it, so it can't do anything to move around on you or anything. Boom. Okay. So now we're up here. And this place is usually really annoying because there's these little smut monster things that are chasing after you. And they're also loud as fuck. Those things. But because we came up in here in an unconventional way without the key card from downstairs, they don't load. So we go through this creepy place not getting chased by anything. There we go, we got tape. And luckily all the doors are open from the other side, so I can actually leave too. Yeah, so there's one that spawns at the end there.
Sorry, with that skip, is it every time you close, you go off in certain...
If you're stuck, yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
In other games, I guess like it'll push you forward, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I don't know what determines the direction necessarily, but... Good girl. Go ahead and get a double feed right here real quick. This NPC, this girl I'm feeding off of, is the most consistent in the game, probably. She's always walking down that section of the street as you come up for some reason. So she's a really nice, consistent feed. And this is our childhood friend. Because we transferred, her scripting is still set to follow us, to try and talk to us, but she can't talk to us. But you can, like... have her follow you into some place, like into this alley if you're just kind of trying to talk to... Oh, I didn't get the first tape. I'm an idiot. I'm thinking about other things. This is why it's unfortunate. If we just could skip that and just watch the tape once. Yeah, I forgot to go to the graveyard. So this is the graveyard. I really wish there was a way to use what I was using to get the tapes here. And the reason for that is because the whole reason we're in Hollywood is to look for the Nosferatu. And the entrance to their like lair or whatever is here. It's right over there. And if you could somehow get below the level and then quick save up into it, you could skip all of Hollywood and go straight to this guy Gary. And then go on to Chinatown. But unfortunately, it doesn't work like that. You can get out of bounds from up here. You can go all the way around, but it doesn't matter because you can't get into like the cavern or whatever that leads to his, that leads to Gary. It sucks. Probably, yeah. Well, not too far.
Yeah, I get this too. I'm in a hurry to find out what's behind the door, so get comfortable. I do have
a few. Pass me that not cup right there.
May be of use to both of us.
Thanks, mate. Orange juice. Important morning nutritional breakfast. I'm sorry. That sounds horrible.
Then this is no doubt the work of a fiend. Hand me the tape. There might be something on it that will give us some insight into what its motives are.
It's great how the second tape really only adds like 5 seconds to the overall film. You'll notice those things have some protruding things behind them. It is both like their butt and their brain, is my theory on that, if you were wondering.
If I make it...
Wait, who is filming that?
We're about to go find the guy who was filming it. Yeah. So the reason why we even want to find those is because it's a masquerade violation, pretty much. And those things are all over the sewers, which is where the Nosferatu are at. Which is why they can't be found by the prince, which is why he wanted us to go look for them. So we're going to beat this guy up. This is essentially the first boss fight of the game. Well, for the route, at least. And his name's Andre. His whole thing is trying to manipulate where, because he likes to warp around like a jerk. But we can try and manipulate where he's gonna spawn, or warp to rather. We'll stand here, look this way. And here he is. Back here, and back here. Okay. Yeah. It's like he can't warp to where you're looking or something like that. Okay. So. Thank you.
So, how many boss fights do you do in the run exactly?
Two.
That was the final one?
She's not the final one. She's just a boss. It's Ming Zhao. She's like this other type of vampire, and she's like Asian. Well, there's mad clans, there's Asians, there's werewolves, there's mages. The whole universe of White Wolf is pretty expansive. Yeah, they are, yeah. They're literally called the Asian vampires, you know? Like, that's not what they're called. I'm being an asshole, but whatever. They do refer to them as Asian vampires, but that's not what they're called, Equajin or something like that. So I used a lot of blood packs on Andre, which I have keybind, obviously. I didn't go to my menu and just do that, but... I do. So here's another skip. This door is actually locked, but you can open it from the other side. And then when you load into this this place, the Warrens, it assumes that you must have come through this cutscene when you first enter this place. So it warps us actually closer to where we need to go, into here, which is where we would be anyways if we did things properly.
I love the clothing.
Yeah, they flow everywhere. A nice ass right there. Those guys have the worst attack. That thing that just flew past me, like, slows you down. It's really awful. Get up there. So our goal here is just to hit these guys into the wall so that we can hit them faster. And the reason why you want to kill them is because you have the lockpick right here, and otherwise they would hit you and stun you a whole bunch, which is not fun. Here I notoriously screw up the jump that is literally easy, so I'm going to save and just make sure that doesn't happen. These things are pretty terrifying the first time you see them. People call them the vagina monster. Yep, that's why you do that. That's literally just a normal jump, too, but bunny hopping to it is so hard. I mean, thank you. Yes, the proper. There we go. I did it. Alright, so here I have to level up. I get blood shield. The reason why we get blood shield is because it helps a lot with our level. And this drop. Oop, okay. Alright, now this is the sewers. This is notoriously the worst place in the game for people, but it's the best place in the speedrun. I'm not scripting right now. See, I'm not scripting right now. So we come up here, and we need to get this card key. And our boy, we cannot help, I'm sorry, but he's gonna die. Pour one out for my boy, the Nasi. So this opens up our entrance to the Nosferatu sewers, so to speak. I'm gonna save real quick. This place is, I have the water turned off because the textures are never fixed ever and they just look really janky. And I guess it slows down other people's performances, so whatever. But the water here is actually lava or some shit like that, so it hurts you. So this is like a tight area to try and like bunny hop through. Yeah, it's annoying. Like all this is water that hurts you for whatever reason. Yeah. I gotta be invited in first or something. Alright, so now we can talk to Gary. We've got a pretty long conversation where he, like, fucks with you while being invisible. So the deal we just made with him is we're going to find his other Nasi boy who is in Chinatown. But we're actually not going to do that at all. So, fuck you, Gary.
Chinatown's definitely the most difficult.
Yeah, so here's the cavern I was talking about, where if you could just get into there, you could just go talk to Gary and skip all of that Hollywood crap I just did. Glitch Hunters, get on it. So Chinatown, we can skip almost entirely, which is kind of nice. And the reason why is because in here we have to go talk to Ming Zhao. But this area is also the area you go to when you go to fight Ming Zhao. So behind this area is another area that we're not supposed to be able to get to. The other hard part about this is that I'm currently in an area which doesn't allow you to use any vampire disciplines or attack anybody. But I have to get through a lot of guards that are like higher level than me, pretty much. So I'm just gonna run through, and you don't necessarily have to hope you don't die, but you have to bait these guys to like open the door and get out of your way and not hit you. That was really good. I didn't get hit at all. Jesus. You don't lose it faster. You just can't use them. Yeah. Like you're in an agreed area where you're not going to do that. Yeah. Like the nightclub's another one. It's called Elysium, whatever, however you know.
Do you have any way to override that?
No, it's like level specific. So here's another door we opened from the other side that you're not supposed to. Now coming up, there's like some spikes that come out of the wall, and for whatever reason, the game, like when you're first in here, doesn't let you move them. So I have to save and quick load to spawn them, and then I can move them.
So just invisible. You don't.
Yeah, pretty much. I'm not sure why that is. All right, so here I take a deliberate kind of pattern to get around some guys who come out of the wall, and it's actually more important than just having them aggro me. They're also the trigger for an infinitely spawning amounts of guards in the next area that I'm going for. So not having them triggered means I won't trigger the other main guards that are in this area, which is the hardest area of the game, by the way. Yeah, there'd be four guards in here, and they would infinitely spawn for, I don't know at what interval, but they do. So my object in this place is I need to get four statues and then set them up correctly so I can then warp to Ming Zhao. But I'm also really low level comparatively. Like, I haven't spent any of my experience. So I don't have, like, the more powerful attacks that they would expect you to have right now. And these fire arrows, man, they do fucking tons of damage. Oh, it's Purge, that's why. This game has automatic hotkeys. You're allowed to customize them, but you have to do it like in-game. Hey, that was really convenient, thank you. Okay, trance please, there we go. Fade out that. Purge these fools. Yeah, they have to be within vision. But then it travels them or something. Oh, I didn't mean to do that. Is he just dead? I don't understand. I want to feed off of him.
Okay. Is there a range to it, or does it just hit?
There is a range to it, yeah. You can only use it when you have something that you can target it on, so that's kind of like a good way to gauge that. Oh, wait, I went past this. No, I didn't. What? Okay. What is this?
Is there a specific...
Yeah, these correspond to specific statues. I should have enough blood for the fight also. Here we go.
Be at peace. Indeed. We did help. LaCroix. Yes.
Yeah, she can shapeshift, so like when we saw Ming Zhao outside... Or when we saw Nines outside of the Grouch mansion, that was actually Ming Zhao. And we call the blood. Yeah, they manipulated us, so we're understandably very mad. Alright, this is where the Elder Vitae comes into play, because obviously the only thing really dealing damage is the blood strike. Oh man. Okay, I'm gonna make sure this works. Blood strike's really nice because it also returns blood to you. So it costs one blood, returns two blood, and it's projectile and it scales. Shit, boss, man. Alright, so this is the final area. Hey, you can get ready on time. So this is Kane, father of all vampires, and taxi driver. That's what he is in the game. People get really mad that he's in here. Alright, here's the final boss. I'll save before him. Yeah. We did it. Alright. We can finish the run now. And when I hit this, it's gonna be time. Time.
53:46.
Hey, all right. Cool. So,
Los Angeles at last is mine. Come. Stand next to me while we open
the best
sarcophagus.
Can we just not? I'll wait. We got to talk to Fat Larry once.
The Ankaran sarcophagus.
Fat Larry is the best combo in the game.
Is it Balthazar? Maybe Lazarus. Or am I to be reunited with Ventru himself?
Or could so is there just one ending to this game?
No. There are four? This is the worst ending, where you side with LaCroix and you open the sarcophagus. The other endings are, there's Independent, where you don't open the sarcophagus and you don't join any of the other clans. There's Anarchist ending, where you join the Anarchs. There's a Camarilla ending where that dude in the red jacket is the Tremere leader, Primogen. You can join him. This is like the bad Camarilla ending. That's like the better Camarilla ending where you just lock up the sarcophagus away forever or something like that. Yep. It's just full of, yeah, explosives.
Who is Jack?
Jack? That's that guy. Played by John DiMaggio. Yeah, that's why they're sitting chilling right now. Yeah. Yeah, this game has excellent voice acting. High tier cast. Alright, we could listen to Lacuna Coil, but we're not gonna do that. Yeah, we're gonna go to the Truck-O-Mac real quick.
The Truck-O-Mac?
The Truck-O-Mac. Oh, you guys don't have audio. That's a damn shame. You should go listen to the thing, honestly. Yeah, he's... This is Fat Larry.
Baby girl, I saw you come from down the street and I started praying to the Lord to find it in his heart to send you to me. And hallelujah if he didn't come through for me. Welcome to Fat Larry's Truck-O-Mac. I am the proprietor and salesman of the month several years in a row. The ladies call me, oh God, but you can call me Fat Larry with a F-A-T.
Because there's more of me to love. Because there's more to me to love.
Oh my God.
Counterfeit? Man, I look like one of those peanut-headed, rock-smoking brothers selling S-H-A-C-K shirts they made at their mama's house. I'm the real deal OG man in the alley with what you need. Counterfeit? Why you gotta be like that? Nah, that's what I like to hear. But it's like this. I save my best stuff for select clientele. Now, that don't mean I don't appreciate your business. It's just, you know, business.
Alright, that's Vampire. Thanks for watching, guys. Stay tuned for more.